game and then looked back a few weeks later and thought, what the hell was I doing putting 80 hours of my life into that? That usually happens because the game used Skinner's techniques to create the illusion of engagement and extend playtime. RPGs, especially poorly made ones, are a great example of this. Everything from loot drops to leveling is a very clear reward schedule that reinforces the behavior that gives you the reward. Ever been playing late, getting sleepy, but then decide that you can get just one more level before you go to bed? But this isn't just an RPG problem.
Sorry,
it's epic. Almost anything with points uses this system. Ask your grandmother sometime why she plays so much in Duel. But it goes beyond points, too. It works with anything that has a clear and manifest reward. Solitaire, the most played game in the world, sets up the infrequent win as a clear reward. Many action games use the same system to convince players to mash the same buttons for 12 hours straight. Even elements like the voiceovers in shooters that tell the player how awesome they are can be used as conditional tools. It's also one of the main reasons every game is getting RPG elements these days. Now, don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong with adding RPG elements if it's being used to create deep, immersive systems for the game. I'm actually a huge fan of this trend when it's used to combine mental challenges and execution challenges like in Call of Duty or Dungeon Fighter. But too many games are using RPG elements as a crutch. Bland, uninspired games will include reward systems simply to delay your realization of how they're playable. My point is, there are other, better ways of fostering engagement, and those are the members we should be demanding from our games, not simple Skinner box satisfaction. Here are a few examples. One, mystery. Human curiosity is a powerful thing. We like unraveling mysteries. We've all played a game that made us ask, what the hell's going on? Immediately followed by, how many people are coming? Two, mastery. The player can be engaged by giving him the opportunity to master a skill and then utilize that mastery. We see this sort of thing in rhythm games, fighting games, sometimes even RPGs.
How do you spell design? Said.
But why don't we use this for almost every part of our games, from plotting out our levels to figuring out the overall arc of the game? We've got no analogous concept for the social side of play. When you get down to it, though, the challenge is a challenge, whether it's mechanical or social. And I've clearly seen games fail because their social play deviates wildly from that curve. So let's talk about this, because as we create games which involve interpersonal interaction, it's important to recognize that a player's skill within the social framework of a game increases over time. Let's take MMOs as an example. If you are anything like me, you start out just playing solo. You periodically form pickup groups and begin to
be better, and then you can remove the green
screen. People to your friends list. Soon you've got a group you adventure with semi-regularly, and you find yourself
and then
using
add
the
some,
all the time to make money.
You know,
put together
music,
a complex ingredient challenge you need
but
to
that's,
practice.
What?
Then,
can
as you get level cap, you join the guild and you start to take on multi-part raids. And hey, if you're a more active player than I usually am, maybe you finally step up to do the heavy lifting and actually run a guild.
Oh, don't worry. We do that in Premiere. It's really easy. Same with what you're doing here. Once I've done with the video, we'll add some. This time we'll actually